Hey guys, it's Lance at McV-audio, and today I'm going to be installing new CPUs into my 2009 Mac Pro 8-core 2.26 GHz. I'm going to be installing two 5650 Xeon 6-core 2.66 processors, which will be upgrading me from a 2009 Nellaheim to a 2010 Westmere 12 core, from 8 cores to 12 cores. And here's a list of the tools you'll need to do the surgery. Just pause the video to get a longer look. The other thing that I have already done is the firmware update, which you have to do before you put in the processors. This will also allow you to use faster RAM. Instead of the 1066, you can now use 1333. Anyway, I'm extremely nervous about this install. You are witnessing me before the surgery. And I've seen a lot of people do this successfully, and I've seen a lot of failures.
It takes a steady hand, because if you touch the side...
Failures can prove to be extremely costly. You can ruin the processors, you can ruin the logic board, or you can ruin both. It's more involved with the 2009 because the chips do not have the integrated heat spreader cover on them. So when you put new chips in, there's a 2 millimeter difference between the original processor that's in there and any replacement you're going to put in there, because of the little silver cap on the processor. So that means things have to be done slightly differently. 2010, you can just pop in the CPU and basically you're done. It's much easier. But 2009 is trickier, but the cost factor is much better. Basically, you can get the 2009 a lot cheaper than a 2010, and then you can upgrade it with used chips. I bought used chips on eBay, so there's another thing that could go wrong. I could have bought a bad chip. So, here we go. I'm going to video it in high speed. I'll see you on the other end, hopefully successfully, with a big smile on my face. Otherwise, you might see me crying, which I really don't want you to see. So stay tuned and keep watching.
Okay, let's operate.
It's Operation the Wacky Doctor's Game, where you're the wacky doctor.
Okay, so here's our patient, and the first thing I do is remove all the RAM from the logic board, just to get it out of the way, basically. So you can see that I put tape on top of the heat sinks, and then I just labeled them, because you want to know which one is A and which one is B. They are not shaped the same, so you got to put A back in the A slot and B back in the B slot. Then what I'm doing is marking the amount of rotations it takes to unscrew one of the screws in the heatsink. And those heatsinks are spring-loaded, the screws rather, so they don't pop out or fall out. They stay in there. And then I put the hex key in and found exactly where it locks into the screw. And then I marked the tape so I knew exactly where I started unscrewing the screw. And when you get to the end, you'll know it, because you'll hear the screw click, which means you've unscrewed it all the way. They don't rise up out of the heatsink. So it was about 9.5 full rotations to unscrew each screw. Then you want to pull straight up as you pull the heatsink off. And then I slowly twisted the processor, which is stuck to the bottom of the heatsink, off the heatsink, and then clean the area with rubbing alcohol and a lint-free cloth. And now what I'm doing is fumbling with a little black connector. Basically, you need to remove the heatsink cable from its housing. And then you want to cut off the black plastic tabs that keep it in the housing. So when you go to reconnect the cable back to the logic board, you push it up through the hole and it'll give you a little slack to make sure the connector is all the way in. Now, you may be able to get away without doing this, but it ensures that it makes proper connection back to the logic board when you put the heatsink back on. And the reason you do this is because the CPUs are thicker than the originals. And if the heatsink cable doesn't make full contact contact with its connector on the logic board, your fans are going to blow at full speed and you're going to have to remove the heatsink, remove the CPU, and start all over again. And never try and put the heatsink back in when the CPU is stuck to the bottom of it. You have to take off the CPU, clean it off, put it back in the CPU socket, put on new thermal paste, so I think it's a safer bet to do it this way. Then the next thing I did was put the thermal pads on the heat sensors. Each CPU has its own heat sensors, so they're not exactly the same size. So CPU A, you cut a piece of the thermal pad to fit CPU A heat sensors, and then do the same for CPU B. You can see CPU B is a thinner strip. And the heat sinks already have thermal pads on them, but we need to add this in addition to them to make up for the difference in the CPU size. Okay, so now I'm inserting the first CPU. The one thing you have to do is make sure there's little two nooks on either side of the CPU that have to line up with two little posts in the socket. Now I'm applying the thermal paste. I went with a method I saw a guy do on YouTube, which is just to put like a pea-sized ball in the very center of the CPU. I didn't spread the thermal paste around like a lot of people do, like it's frosting on a cake. I just use this method and the heatsink spreads it around onto the CPU. This is the trickiest part, which is to reinsert the now loose cable from the heatsink to the logic board. It was not easy. Connect the cable first to the logic board and then guide the heatsink straight down on top of the CPU. So I reinserted the connector to the logic board from the heatsink and then I guided down the heatsink straight down onto the CPU, gently. So here's a better look at the bottom of the heatsink and the loose connector. See how the loose connector is coming up through the channel now? That's the way you want it. And then you have to put the wire back into the channel before you reinsert the heatsink. And now I'm adding another pea-sized drop of thermal paste onto the second processor and then I'm going to reinsert the connector first. So I get the connector in there, it clicked in very nicely, and then I'm going to guide down the heatsink nice and slow on top of the CPU. Okay, so here's the critical part of this operation, which is to not overscrew the heatsinks when you put them back in and count the amount of turns that you've done as you put them back in. It took about 3.5 turns on each screw till I started feeling a little bit of pressure, and I went with that for starters, even though I think in the end it's going to be more like 4.5 turns, because you don't want to overscrew them in. If you overscrew them in, you can crush the CPU and the logic board and all the pins on there. Okay, thumbs up, fingers crossed.
The operation, she is done.
Okay, kids. Please, please let it work. I have to say, it's pretty nerve-wracking because there's a lot of variables. So if something goes wrong, you're not really gonna know what it is. Could not be enough pressure down on the CPU, could not be enough thermal paste, the little connectors that go from the motherboard into the heat sinks. So here, you're gonna see my response, my reaction to whether this baby's gonna be a 12 core or a no core. Please let it be a 12 core.
Here goes his fanny band, don't get nervous.
There's the power button. I'm really scared. Fans are dying down, that's a good sign. Oh no, power light is flashing. We're a no-go.
I blew it!
Well, after tightening down the heat sinks another quarter turn, half a turn each, she boots. But there's one problem. One RAM chip was not showing up in slot 2 of 8 slots.
I did it! That's $200!
I'm smiling now because after a few more turns of the heatsink on the first CPU, all channels of memory came up. So now we got 8 gigs of RAM in there, which is the older RAM. I'll be putting 32 gigs RAM in there. Whew! I am glad it's over. It took me probably 2 hours altogether because I was very careful and it's really tricky. I don't think I recommend it unless you really have the balls to go for it, because it's, and you got to read up and read up and read again, because if you over tighten those CPU screws, you're going to kill everything, your CPUs and your logic board.
It takes a steady hand, because if you touch the side.
So anyway, thanks for tuning in. See you on the next McV Audio video.
Operation, a game from Milton Bradley.